right now it's basically a it's basically this timer. And so the idea is like we live in a world where it's easy to get distracted by things like whether or not you're like ADD person, like it's easy to get distracted by things. So people have written about like techniques of like setting timers and like focusing really hard on something, and then when the timer goes off, you like walk around and take a break and like get a glass of water, like for your health, and then when you go back to focusing, you set a timer. So I just wrote a little interface that allows you to start a sprint within like some parameters, so like 15 minutes, or you know, if you want to work for 20 minutes, you just click, and it starts this little timer, and it counts down to zero, and when it hits zero, I'll just start a 0 minute timer, plays a little sound, and then when you click, it stops, and then you can like do things like, you know, when you start the timer, it makes little log entries. So like, if you start a 20 minute timer, you can be like working on thing, and you can say like got distracted or whatever. I want to make this so that when the timer hits zero, it gives you like a 5-star thing that you can click, so you can like rate yourself 1 star. If you got distracted and didn't get any work done, you can rate yourself 1 star. And if you were really productive, you can rate 5 stars. And then basically the goal is to find ways to change your work habits so that you're doing 5-star work and not getting distracted. I think it'd be cool to like find, it'd be like a sort of quantified self thing of like how often you're doing quality, like productive work, and how you can change your work habits to be more productive. And I think, like, so when the timer hits zero, being able to rate yourself 1 to 5 stars would be cool. But right now, this is pretty much all it is. So, has anyone here, I think there's some, like, newish programmers here. Has anyone used Processing? Anyone not heard of Processing? Okay. So I think Processing is really cool for new programmers because it allows you to quickly do like sort of visual things really easily. So check out Processing. Go to processing.org. And then there's this really cool JavaScript library called P5, which basically takes all the stuff from Processing and turns it into JavaScript libraries. And you can download this like IDE if you want. Do this. So this is like my sketch, and then here's my HTML page. Here's like the star rating thing that I'm trying to work on, and then it's just CSS. So all the JavaScript lives in here, and then there's 2 sound files. And it's pretty simple. Like I'm not a good programmer, and I was able to do this pretty quickly. So yeah, I guess that's pretty much it. If you want to check it out, it is on GitHub. It's, my username's ultralame, and it's called Doing Things. And yeah, if you want to talk about P5 or Processing, I'll be around for the next like 10 minutes or so, or for the rest of the Cyber Wizard Institute. So yeah, that's Doing Things. Thank you.
Thank you. were talking about screens. That's a good call. Oh, he just gets chopped.
Yeah.
Well, another joke command of the day that I remember is that you maybe like CD into something, and then very quickly afterwards you'll type LS, right? But if you do that too quickly, you might type SL, in which case this train will come across the screen, and you won't be able to type while that happens, so it punishes you for typing too quickly.
No, was that that part?
You won't be able to type while the train is going.
And it stands for steam locomotive.
Okay, so while I was learning myself the Node.js for MarchWind, I'm a fan of these things called functional idioms, which has got a lot of theory and I may explain later, but for now I just want to lead by example. And you may hear other people talk about this library called underscore.js. And so I learned that very quickly to help myself do a couple of things. And one of the biggest things is that if you're going to use underscore.js and Node at the same time, typically you would do this to import underscore. That doesn't work in Node because in the interpreted mode, which I like to use because I enjoy just interpreting my code very quickly, because the underscore is reserved for something else, so beware that if you follow tutorials online, you can't, this won't work. But luckily, you can just name the underscore character to be anything, so in this case I call it un. So I think in one of the learn your node, you have to like make a list, or one of the ways to make something is that there'll be this list, which will have a couple, you'll have to like check to see if like all the, in the synchronous responses to see if they've all returned. And like a way to do that is to like make a list of, you know, three, and then they'll either be true or false whether or not they responded. And so typically one thing that you can do is you might do something like all or false, and this will be equal to like true, and then you will do something like list dot for each, and then like iterate over them, and then try and manipulate this so that they're, you know, they're, well anyway, you would do this big loop and that would be ugly, and I don't want to do it that way. And there are these things called functional idioms which would allow you to do something like this. So there are these two functions called, one of them is called any. So if I call underscore dot any on list, it will say true. And what any does is that it looks at this list, and if any of the values are true, then it returns true. So there's also another component to any which takes a list, and it's called all. And what all does is it looks to see if all of the things inside the list are true. So instead of, I mean, this is like much simpler than like iterating over the list and checking for something manually. So that's kind of a nice thing. Underscore, so another thing that you might need to do is filter a list, which I think you do previously. So I think you had this list of like text names, right? Which was like, I don't remember what they were exactly, but there were some like file names. Okay, so let's just, so here are our file names. And, okay, that's a good text format. Okay, so, oops. I need to do this properly. Oops. Okay. Oh, I wrote films. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is really quite annoying that it's at the bottom of my screen. Does that work in the node?
No, control L. It's like the mesh.
But it doesn't seem to.
No, control L.
Oh, control L.
That's
okay.
Mesh.
So, okay, file names. So, if I wanted to. Normally. I want to, I can also, it also comes with this thing called filter. So the thing that you pass the filter are going to be, the first argument is going to be list to filter. And the second thing will be like the filter function. And this should return a rule. Okay, this is not going to work, those are undefined. But, oh, I shouldn't have done that. Okay, so anyway, so just to give you that, so the, I'm going to filter the file names. And the function that I'm going to pass is going to be an anonymous function, and it's going to be return, oops. So the, it's, the function is going to take an x, it's going to split the x on the dot, and then it's going to look at the second part of that, which is the index number 1, and then we'll look at whether that is equal to md, which is the markdown. And then I will try and close this properly, and then close this properly. And then you see it returned a list with one item, which was just the item that was the only item that returned true under the under this function. So these kind of notions of like filtering or any, or like basically they're all kind of like list processing, right? Like operations on lists occur in many other languages, and underscore provides them for JavaScript. And if you see those, if you see the notions of list processing in any other language and you want to do them in JavaScript, then underscore is what does it. And hopefully that was a good introduction to underscore for me. Yeah. Did you want to?
Well, JavaScript already has a lot of those.
Okay.
It doesn't have all of them, but it has like filter and instead of any, it has some. Instead of all, it has every.
Oh, really?
It just goes into a race. Yeah.
Okay. Well, there is, there are other things that underscore will do with like 70 or then. So, if you got used to doing an underscore, underscore, you might have, like, contains it probably has, right? Pluck, does it have max and min?
It's got mat dot max. Dot apply, so it's not as nice, but you can like dot apply it and look at this.
Well, the nice thing is that it's like, it looks nice here, I guess.
Okay.
And to me that's important. So it provides a lot of array functions, some of which are already used. Well, like, does it have zip by default?
No.
Okay. I'll show you what zip is quickly. Okay, list one is going to be A, B, C. So this is something that's built into Python, which I'm giving a talk about tomorrow. And this will be 1, 2, 3. Oops. Okay, so then und.zip. List one, list two, and it will return like a pairing of the first element of a list of length, a list of length 3, the same length as the input list, except each element will be of length 2, and we'll have this as the first element and this as the second element, and that'll be useful for coercing that into a dictionary. What do you call them now in your language?
Associative arrays.
No, objects.
Objects. Yeah.
Oh. Maps.
Can you, can I wrap this in an object or something? This should work like that. I don't know how it works, but that would be close to if I went to the code.
Oh, of course it. No, you have to do like that reduce.
Okay.
And build this object.
Anyway, there are like list processing ideas that you can do with underscore. That's what I wanted to show you. I'm so, okay, tomorrow all the things that I'm used to doing will probably work on screen.
Thank you,
guys. Come on, Ron. Do you need this?
I have. show you.
So it's called All the Tunes. I actually have a website up for you right now. But this is going to be the new version. So you can do a fuzzy search. And this comes from the Internet Archive, because the general history of this book is it was just handwritten by people, and so the publishers never got paid for this stuff, so it has a semi-legal status. But the Internet Archive posts all these, so I just figured out their naming scheme, how they process PDFs, and getting clearing the server for like that page. Somehow, Internet Archive can serve up an image out of a book, out of a PDF that they post. And they do it, it takes about one day. So I just uploaded this one last night, and they processed it, and you keep checking the page back again, and they say, we're doing this to it, we're doing that to it. But it's really cool what they do. One note thing that I wanted to share in making this. This is my hacky database, in the quote. All the tunes are stored in this giant JSON file. Bigger? All the
make the text bigger.
Are just stored in a giant JSON file, and that object that I require and I send to the browser file are just like just a giant JSON file and then some functions that to search the JSON file for the tune. So you can actually go and check it next year. You can actually ask it for tune. That'll give you all of them. So I actually have almost 2,000 tunes.
Yeah.
More.
Yeah.
And we can do. And here's I'll show you the fuzzy search working. So someone misspelled dolphin. I'm a horrible speller. Dolphin dance. It will give you. It'll actually get you dolphin dance.
No.
Actually, this was actually the reason why I wrote it, or one of the fuzzy search, because Stella by Starlight Talk is usually just, people just say Stella.
Well, we
have
lots of each other.
Stella by Starlight comes up. That's it.
Great.
share with me, and then I'll just read them on the site that you're commenting about. Yeah. I don't know if I'm going to finish that in the next 3 weeks. I'll try.
Awesome.
Yeah. I'm going to show you some cool things that happen when, like, when I have, like, all this weird stuff running around the internet, and when it's all on the internet already. That might help. Are we recording?
Yes.
Cool. Let's make it bigger. Traffic today, and I saw that the page on the hovering cycle has gotten a lot of hits today. Well, I actually didn't see it quite this way, but I'm not going to show you exactly the link that I got this from, but I could tell from one of the visits that it had been shared on the Sudoku mailing list based on the way the person had accessed the page. So then I looked at the Sudoku mailing list, and there weren't quite this many posts at the time. I don't get the emails if there are too many of them. I turn them off, but I saw that Max had sent this email, and that Leslie had sent this email that links to the thing. So then I found out where it was coming from, and then I responded to the email, of course. But responding to the email involved, I first responded with the basic things, like, but there were some things that came up, like Jordan said that that my data indicated that neither cismen, that. She made a conclusion about my study that I didn't think was correct, but I wasn't sure, so I wanted to test it. And in order to do that, I had to find the stuff that I'd written years ago. But fortunately, all my stuff is on the internet, except for this stuff, because some of it was private data. But so I searched around the internet for Risley toilets, because this was about my college dorm, and I didn't even tell you what was going on. It doesn't matter. It was something about toilets, and one of the papers had something to do with the toilets in my dorm, which was called Risley Hall in college. And I searched around and I couldn't find anything. But I also tried searching somewhere here. Oh, yeah, that's right. I can't see because I made the screen bigger. One of the things I did is I thought I had this thing that researched my email, and I thought this would find me some relevant emails. So I ran this weird search term that I can do because I have this weird search term in my email. And another thing I did, I'm not going to show this to you because there's a lot of private stuff on here, but if I run this command, I get to see all my private Git repositories. And I looked through there and I found it eventually. And then I was able to check, I ran this thing. I opened the file up, the spreadsheet that had the data, and I ran the thing that I hadn't put in the report, but responded to Jordan's comments and confirmed that her sarcastic comment was indeed false. Or sarcastic isn't the right word, but her joke comment that she didn't intend to be true was indeed false. That's all.
Industrial robot arm in the other room back there, in Pseudo Room. Images, Pseudo Room, robot arm. That'll probably turn up at least an image of a robot arm. There we go.
haven't seen it, it's very close, you should stop by. So we have this giant robot arm, and it can accept commands over a serial cable, basically. So previously, a bunch of us, Jake and some others, got this robot arm working from SVGs. So I built this interface a while ago. You can upload an SVG into it. If I go to media vector, so here I have an Apatosaurus, and what this program will do is it converts SVGs, which are vectors, into robot arm assembly code. So this is code that the robot natively understands. It's actually just ASCII text, so it's this. It's all of the code in this box here. So it's this like job name. It has a huge list of points. So it has 1,489 points, which is actually too many, so we've got to scale down the resolution a bit. So you can just drag the slider very slowly, I guess the other direction. It becomes more and more abstract the more you slide it one way. So almost fit on the robot, this memory. This one will fit. So we did something like this with a different file, actually, which was a Tatasaur wireframe. So I took that image and I converted it into wireframe. So we could get many more, much more resolution out of this one because it didn't have as many like fancy lines for shading and stuff like that. So we took this image last night. The problem was, as we were drawing stuff, it was drawing things all rotated wrong and like flipped around the X wrong because we hadn't really tested any of that stuff in a while. So Karen and I were mostly hacking on that. So we spent like, you know, 2 or 3 hours writing this code that you see here. This is the change. It was that stupid. So it's like flipping a term around x minus px min instead of px max minus x. So that was a good productive few hours. And then later in the night, once Karen had left, Jake and I went over the code on the pair programming station and we came up with this code, which also flipped the X and the Y around so that we could rotate the image so that it looked like the robot was drawing it as it was moving. So with that stuff in place, we made a robot Apatosaurus. So here's a really crappy picture of it. That's the robot arm and it's like drawing from its perspective, so the robot arm is in the bottom left, sort of drawing that dinosaur, or here's like a close up. Or here's the actual paper, which is much higher. Drawn by an industrial robot in the other room. It's like 980 points ish from a vector that's like downsampled using a bunch of modules and all kinds of crazy crap. But there we go. So the repos that do this are called Robot Arm Art on the Pseudoroom GitHub, Robot Arm Art. And the module that we were hacking on, with all of those like changes that took way too long for such a small bit, this was all in this module called Inform2D that takes line segments, basically, and turns it into that inform code. So that's what I was doing last night. Thanks.
from when the person talks into their microphone. That's all I want. But that was not what I found here. So I went to this other thing, which is I did capturing. This is capturing audio and video in HTML5. So I looked through all this stuff. Media store, screenshots, blah blah blah. So they have both audio and video. So then I finally got to this part with using the web audio API. And finally, this is a snippet of code that's like much more like my speed, like something I can really work with to get a basic understanding of like what I'd even have to do in order to access the microphone. So this is, you know, the window. We know what the window is. It's everything that's in the window. So what we do is we create a new audio context, which, whatever, it's just like that area where you're going to be working with web audio. And so now we instantiate it and create a new one. And in effect, we do get user media, and get user media defaults to audio and video true, but I only want audio true. And then there's like this other stuff, and it, in effect, it returns a stream. And I was like, great, a stream. Like, I've heard of those. Like, streams give me data. Like, that's what I want. So, and they had a really cool demo, including a live input visualizer, which I will show you here. But I basically thought this was really, really neat and wanted to do something similar. And so I started to implement this stuff, but I kind of hit a wall because the last thing on here that you need to know is the context.destination, which is where the stuff from the mic will eventually end up. And the destination is automatically set to your speakers. But I'm like, I want it to play. Don't play what I put into the microphone. Just give me the information so that I can do other stuff with it, like make a visualization or add some kind of effects or store it, whatever. But alas, I could not do that. So this is a little bit of using that stuff. So you can see, create media streams, source, etc. After a long time of looking with help, I found this page, visualizations with the web audio API, which is more along what I was looking for. And it turns out that you have to create this thing called an analyzer that will actually be the thing that gives you the data. So make your context, then you like do this create media stream with a source, and then you add the analyzer, which you will maybe get some data out of. So we tried that, but it only gives you one point of data. And it's like, now what? I just want the row of numbers and just the numbers to keep coming as new data comes in. But I could not get that. So what we had to do is do a set interval to basically get this analyzer to print out the actual data every half a second. And there was all this other stuff. Like we had to give it a buffer length and make an array out of it. I could not have done this by myself. And so when we quit, use your microphone. Let's pull up our console. Oh. trying to get one of them to make, like, just wants, like, rainbow lines and stuff. So, from your microphone. The end. Thank you.
So we can teach people how to sing by numbers now.
Something
Notish in Python is the first one. That's what will happen.